ده حديث يا رجل انت حيمتنا. A group of Sahaba came to Nabi عليه الصلاة والسلام and listened to what they said to Nabi عليه الصلاة والسلام. الله أكبر, they said, يا رسول الله ذهب أهل الدسور بالأجور. Look at the concern of the Sahaba. Said, يا رسول الله ذهب أهل الدسور بالأجور, that the rich men have taken all the ثواب. This is the concern. That the rich men have taken all the ثواب and the أجر. Why? يصلون كما نصلي. والنبي عليه الصلاة والسلام, they also pray and we pray. That is equal. ويصومون كما نصوم. They fast, we fast. We are equal. ويتصدقون بفضول أموالهم. والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, they are surpassed. Why? Because Allah has given them wealth. And they're able to donate. They're able to give sadaqah. And because we have no wealth, والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, we are unable to give sadaqah. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, what shall we do? They have taken all the ajr, they have taken all the ثواب and reward. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said to them, أوليتك جعل الله لكم ما تصدقون? Hasn't Allah given you such a thing? If you do this thing, then you also will receive the reward of صدقة. إن بكل تصبيحة صدقة وكل تكبيرة صدقة وكل تحميدة صدقة وكل تهليلة صدقة وأمر بالمعروف صدقة ونحي عن منكر صدقة وفي بضع أحدكم صدقة. Every time you say Alhamdulillah, you will receive the reward of صدقة. Every time you say سبحان الله, you will receive the reward of صدقة. Every time you say الله أكبر, Allah is the greatest, you will receive the reward of صدقة. You see somebody doing bad and you tell him not to do this, you will receive the reward of sadaqah. You tell your friend to do something good, you call him towards prayer, you teach him to do good, you will receive the reward of sadaqah. To the extent, وَفِي بُضِ أَحَدِكُمْ صَدَقٌ صَدَقَةٌ in the eyes of Allah, you come to your wife and you fulfill your need and desire, you will receive the reward of sadaqah. Sahaba was surprised. And they asked, يا رسول الله أيأتي أحدنا شهوته ويكون له فيها أجر. ونبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, one of us comes to his wife and he fulfills his need and desire and the Almighty will reward him for this, he will give him the reward of صدقه. They could not comprehend. نبي عليه الصلاة والسلام explained, tell me, if he was to do it the haram way, if he was to fulfill his need and desire with somebody other than his wife, will Allah, will he not be considered as a sinner in the eyes of Allah? Will he not have sinned? They understood. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, likewise, if he was to fulfill his need the right way with his wife, then he will be rewarded for it. So when this concept was firmly established that marriage is not just a transaction but an act of worship ordained by Allah and practiced by His Messenger and a sacred act, Islam slowly began to prohibit all the wrongs that were rife in society with regards to marriage in the days of ignorance. The Quran announced, لا تجمع بين الأختين إلا ما قد صلح. You will not keep two sisters in your nikah at any one time. لا تنكحوا ما نكح آباؤكم من النساء إلا ما قد سلف. There is no such thing as nikah imak. There is no such thing as marrying your father's wife after his death. نهى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عن الشغار. There is no such thing as nikah شغار. فانكحوا ما طاب لكم من النساء مثنى وثلاث ورباع. You will restrict yourself to four maximum with the condition of equality and justice, and you will not marry more than four. You will not marry five and ten as you once did. وآتوا النساء صدقاتهن نحلة. And you will not keep the dowry. You will give them their dowry. لا تنكح الأيم حتى تستأمر ولا تنكح البكر حتى تستأذن. And you will not force them to marry somebody who they do not wish to marry. Islam began to prohibit all the wrongs that were rife in society with regards to marriage in the days of ignorance. Now, out of all the loads that were rife in the days of ignorance, one which still remains to this very day, and especially amongst those that have come from Pakistan, India and Bangladesh, is this one in which a man or woman who is sane and mature, has reached the age of puberty, is not consulted at the time of his marriage, and is forced into marrying somebody he or she does not wish to marry, somebody he or she dislikes. Some a black male, some are threatened, and some are severely beaten. And when a marriage like this takes place, what happens? 99.99% divorce. Within a matter of few days, years to the most, sometimes the girl runs away to the social services and Allah forbid what happens there. Sometimes he or she goes to live with the partner he or she has chosen, this time without nikah, and this time living the haram way. And the media pick up stories like this. They're waiting to pick up stories like this, and then they begin to relate this as being an Islamic problem. And as I've mentioned, their aim and objective is just to hurt Islam. The aim and objective is just propaganda against Islam and create hatred for Islam in the hearts of the masses, Muslims and non-Muslims alike. So nobody goes towards Islam. They want to turn people away from Islam. Yet this are the teachings of Islam. And they're always looking for opportunities like this. Yes, we agree that the issue or the problem of forced marriages exists within our society. It's not a thing that can be denied. But one thing is for certain, it is not an Islamic problem. It is a cultural problem. It exists among Sikhs and Hindus or non-Muslims. It exists within Pakistanis, Bengalis, Gujaratis, Punjabis, Pathans. It exists within those people that have come from Pakistan, India, Bangladesh, whether they are Muslims or whether they are non-Muslims. Islam is free from allegations made like this against Islam. Because in Islam, marriage is not seen as a transaction. It is seen as an act of worship. When you have married, you have acted upon one of the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you are receiving reward for it. It is a unique thing, and the thing that Islam has to offer to a bride and groom, no religion offers what Islam has to offer. The teachings of Islam are pure, and they cannot be touched. Islam teaches that those in authority cannot force those under their charge, yet in their charge, to marry somebody who they do not wish to marry. It teaches that those in charge should consult and ask permission from those who are in their charge. Listen to the hadith of Rasulullah SAW in this respect. The hadith narrated by Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala an, that our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Al-ayyimu ahakku. Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam said, La tunkahu al-ayyim hatta tusta'mar. Wa la tunkahu al-bitr hatta tusta'zan. Nabi alayhi salatu wa sallam said that a previously married woman shall not be married till she gives consent. And a virgin shall not be married till permission is asked from her. The Sahaba asked, Ya Rasulullah, wa kayfa idhnuha? Wa Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how will we know that she has given